अस्सलामु अलैकुम वरहमतुल्लाह। गुड डे स्टूडेंट्स, आई होप यू आर डूइंग वेरी वेल इन इन योर हाउस एंड आई होप यू आर हेल्दी एंड हैप्पी। सो एज ऑलवेज इट वुड हैव बीन मोर फ्रूटफुल इफ यू ऑल वेर इन द क्लास, राइट? सो यू आर ए मेजर मिसिंग राइट नाउ। So today we will start the first chapter of half yearly biology of class 10, that is control and coordination. Control and coordination. So you have to understand this chapter very chronologically, right? We will go step after step and we will discuss this chapter step by step, right? So the first thing we will talk about is control. What exactly is control? What do we mean when we say control, right? So when we say control, we ensure something function as it is supposed to function, right? Not something more, not something less, just perfectly as it is supposed to function. Take our heart for example, right? Our heart is controlled in such a way so that it can beat for the entire life. If our heart stop beating, then we will be dead, right? And another example, if our kidneys are controlled in such a way so that they can filter out all the waste from our body, all the toxic from our body, right? So this is the way all the organ of our body, they are function, they are controlled in such a way so that they can function properly. So not just only the organs of our body, everything in the universe are controlled by something or some forces. So here we'll discuss about the control and coordination of living thing, right? So we have understood what is control. Control means to ensure functioning of something the way they are supposed to function. So in case of living being, to ensure the functioning of the organs or the organism as they are supposed to function. Now what is coordination? Coordination means what? When something coordinate among themselves, right? When two or more of something that are involved in a specific task, so in order to do the task more efficiently, they need to coordinate it. So to understand coordination better, let's take the digestive system of our body for example, which you have studied in the previous chapter, life process. So we see there are many organs that are involved in the digestive system or the digestion system. There is mouth involved, there is esophagus involved, there is a stomach involved, there is a liver, pancreas, large and small intestine. There are so many organs that are involved in our digestive system, right? So we see all the organs play their part in order to ensure an efficient digestion. Now how do this organ know what to do and when to do? So there is certain system that coordinate among between all these organs so that an efficient digestion can be performed, right? So we see coordination is very important in living organism or living thing, whatever you say. Control and coordination, right? Now, how many types of coordinations are there? We'll discuss about coordination. So we have said coordination means what? When something coordinate with, when two or more things coordinate with each other to perform a function very efficiently, we say it's coordination. Now, what are the different type of coordination found in living thing? There are two different type of coordination we see. One is the chemical coordination. And the other is the electrical coordination. So we'll discuss this step by step. Now what is chemical coordination? When coordination are performed by using certain chemicals in the body. These are called chemical coordination. Now, what are those chemicals? These chemicals are hormones, and hence we can also say it as hormonal coordination. Hormonal coordination. And what is electrical coordination? Electrical coordination are those coordination which require, which are performed through electrical impulses in the nervous system. So we can also say electrical coordination as nervous coordination. So we saw there are two type of coordination: the chemical coordination, the electrical coordination, or the hormonal coordination, or the nervous coordination. So these are the major type of coordination we see in plants and human beings, right? So we'll discuss about these two type of coordination in this chapter. Now, both of this type of coordination has their own advantage and disadvantages. For example, the first advantage, if we look in electrical coordination, since the nervous coordination are performed by certain electrical impulses, so it is really fast. It is very fast. We know the electricity, na? Electricity is very fast, and this hormonal coordination is relatively slower. Relatively slower. One is extremely fast and the other is relatively slower. Now, one advantage of chemical coordination is, see, chemical coordination are performed by hormones. What is hormones? We'll discuss in the later part of the chapter. And hormones are released directly into the bloodstream and they can reach cell to cell, right? So the reach of hormonal coordination is cell to cell. Means what? Their reach is remote. Means what? They can reach cell to cell. Right? They can reach in every cell. But same is not in the case of nervous coordination. They only reach to the places where their nerves are present. And another advantage of chemical coordination is, since hormones are involved in chemical coordination, so they regulate growth. Regulate growth. How they regulate growth, which hormone regulate growth, everything we'll discuss in the later part of chapter. See, chemical coordination two types, sorry, coordination of two types: chemical coordination, electrical coordination. Chemical coordination are performed by hormones, electrical coordination are performed by nervous system or nerves. We'll discuss it. And one more thing, since we will discuss coordination in plants and animals, so it is very important to note that which type of coordination is found in where. So if we look at the coordination of human, we'll see the coordination of human is performed by or in both chemical coordination and nervous coordination. We'll see both chemical coordination and nervous coordination in case of human, but in case of plant, we will see only hormonal coordination. Only hormonal coordination. So we will discuss it step by step. First, let us discuss the coordination in animal. Coordination in human. Yeah, this is in your syllabus, the coordination in human. Coordination in human, as I said earlier, is of two types. There is nervous coordination and there is hormonal coordination. So first we'll discuss about nervous coordination. The nervous coordination, various types, the nerves involved, the organ involved, we'll discuss the nervous coordination first. So what is nervous coordination? I have discussed earlier. Nervous coordination are those type of coordination that require the nervous system or the nerves, and where it is found? It is found in animals. In this case, it is found in human. And what are the advantage of nervous system? It is faster than the hormonal coordination. Now, nervous coordination are again divided into two more types. Or what? Okay, I'll make a separate flow chart of nervous coordination. Nervous coordination, I'm making a separate flow chart of nervous coordination. So nervous coordination in human involved two major parts. One is the central nervous system and the other is the peripheral nervous system. Don't worry, we will discuss each and every step one by one. Now the central nervous system include, you know, what is central nervous system? The main, the headquarter of all the nervous system is said to be as the central nervous system, center, the headquarter. Now central nervous system, it consists of two major organs of the nervous system, that is the brain and the spinal cord. The brain and spinal cord are the major organs that are present in the central nervous system. Brain and the spinal cord, we'll come back to it later. We'll discuss elaborately about brain and about spinal cord. Now what is peripheral nervous system? So in order to understand what is peripheral nervous system, you have to understand the word periphery. Now what is periphery? Take a jar for example, a small jar. Yeah, small jar. Suppose this is a jar. So this is the center of axis. This is the center of axis and these are the periphery. Sorry. These are the periphery, means what? The side region are the periphery, means what? The surrounding region is the periphery region. So the nerves that are present in the side or in the surrounding are known as peripheral, consists the peripheral nervous system. Now suppose this is a human body. Suppose, so the this is a human body. The brain is present here and the spinal cord is present somewhat here, right? Now peripheral nervous system consists of two more type of nerves. The nerves that arises from the brain and the nerves that arises from the spines, right? The nerves that arises from the brain, you know, the nerves in the facial area. So this type of brain, this type of nerves, the nerves that arises from the brain are known as cranial nerves. And the nerves that arises from the spinal cord are known as spinal nerve. Very easy. Spinal nerves. See, spinal nerves usually the brain is in the upper part of our body. This is the head region. So most of the nerves or the nerves that are present in the facial region are the cranial nerve, because it is originated from the brain, and in the rest of the body we see spinal nerve because it is originated from the spines. Alright. Now again, peripheral nervous system, in peripheral nervous system we will see two type of nerves, that is the sensory nerve and the motor nerve. See, what is peripheral nervous system? The nerves that are present in the side of the body. Now two type we have seen, there are cranial nerves arising from the brain and the spinal nerve arising from the spines, right? Now peripheral nerves are of two types, the sensory nerves and the motor nerve. See, just, you know, go through the terms, you know, it will make it even more easier. Sensory nerves, when we say sensory nerves, right? The nerves that receive sensory information, right? The nerve that receives the impulse, the nerves that receives information. So receives information and send it to the central nervous system. Suppose this is a hand. Don't mind the drawing, please. Suppose this is a hand. So something has touched in your hand. So there is something in your hand. So this information will carry will be carried to the central nervous system. So the nerves that carries the information from the sense organs to the central nervous system, those nerves are termed as sensory nerves. So after delivering the information to the central nervous system, the central nervous system will deliver some information to the effector organ. Okay, let me make it more clear with an example. Okay, suppose in your this hand, in your left hand, there is a mosquito biting, right? And what you did is you use your right hand to kill that mosquito. So what did actually happen? When the mosquito was, you know, biting you, an information and an impulse was sent to your brain, and this information or the impulse was processed in your central nervous system, and you know it instructed your right hand to, you know, kill or to, you know, remove the mosquito. So the information that was sent to the brain was sent through the sensory nerves, and after processing it in the central nervous system, your central nervous system, you know, ordered your right hand, you know, to remove the mosquito or to kill the mosquito. So this is was the effector organ. This was the sensory organ. This was the effector organ, because this organ has affected it, right? So this organ, the information from the central nervous system to the effector organ was passed or was sent through the motor nerve. The motor nerve what? The motor nerve receives information from the central nervous system, and the sensory nerve, it sends information or impulses to the central nervous system. One sends it to the central nervous system, CNS, and one receives information from the central nervous system. Right? I think we are clear up to this. Now again, motor nerves are of two types. Motor nerves are of two type. One is somatic nerves. Somatic and autonomic. Motor nerves are again of two type. Somatic and autonomic. Somatic nerves are those nerves. Now what are somatic nerves and autonomic nerves? We have said that motor nerves are those nerves that, you know, carries information from the central nervous system to the effector organ, all right, or to the target organ. So motor nerves are of two types, somatic and autonomic. Somatic nerves are those nerves, you know, that control the voluntary function or voluntary movement of the body, and autonomic nervous system contain those nerves that, you know, control the involuntary function of the body, right? Motor nerves are of two types, somatic nerves and the autonomic nerves. Somatic nerves are a part of those of the nervous system that control the voluntary function, and autonomic nerves are the part of those nervous system that control the involuntary movements. Now what is voluntary and involuntary? Voluntary and involuntary. Voluntary movements are those movements which are under your control, right? Suppose I am discussing, right? I am moving the finger. So these are the voluntary movements, the movements that are under your control, and these are performed by somatic nervous system, and the autonomic nervous system perform the involuntary movements are those movements which are not under your control, Suppose the movement of the beating of your heart, it's a movement that is not under your control, right? So the heart will beat until the last breath of your life, or until your last breath. So it will be controlled by autonomic nerves. So there are certain movements, like the movements of organs. In life process, we saw the esophagus and the other stomach. These are all, constantly performing some kind of movement. We said that those movements are called peristaltic movement. So the movement of the organs, the movement that we can't control, are performed by autonomic nervous system. For example, the beating of the heart is a classic example. So again, human coordination are performed by nervous coordination and hormonal coordination. Nervous coordination, we have started to discuss nervous coordination in human. So nervous coordination includes two parts: the central nervous system, the peripheral nervous system. The central nervous system consists of brain and spinal cord, which we'll discuss in the later part of the chapter, and peripheral nervous system consists of those nerves that are present in the periphery of the body. It consists of two types of nerves: the sensory nerves and the motor nerve. Motor nerves again are divided into two more types: somatic and autonomic. Somatic, that control the voluntary function, and autonomic, that control the involuntary functions. Right now, just one more step in the flow chart. Now again, this autonomic nervous system, these are again divided into two more subdivision. One is sympathetic and the other is parasympathetic. I know it's getting a bit long for you, but don't worry, this is the last phase of this division. Now, autonomic nervous system, as I have mentioned earlier, control the involuntary movements of your body. Means what? The movement that are not under your control. Now, what does sympathetic nervous system do? Consider a classic example. Suppose you are being chased by a dog. So what will you do? Your heart will start to increase its metabolic rate. Means what? Your heartbeat will increase, your pupil will dilate, your muscle will start using more and more energy, right? So sympathetic nervous system control all this function, all those involuntary function. To be very specific, sympathetic nervous system control those involuntary function that require use of more and more energy. During the fight or flight response, when our body is in an excited state, it uses a lot of energy. So these activities are performed by sympathetic nervous system, and all those involuntary activities that does not require a lot of energy are performed by parasympathetic nervous system. For example, suppose after your iftar you feel very relaxed, right? You tend to go to sleep. When you go to sleep, what exactly happened? Or when you feel very relaxed, your heartbeat will start to become slower, right? Your body will become very much relaxed. Means what? You will start to you will use less energy. And when you sleep, your body start to perform digestion. So while digesting, you will when your body will be relaxed, you will use very less energy. So parasympathetic nervous system control all those involuntary function that calms down your body, or when you are relaxed. Means what? It saves your energy. And unlike parasympathetic nervous system, sympathetic nervous system acts when your body is in excited state, and it utilizes a lot of energy. With this, we are done with the peripheral nervous system. So let us discuss the various part of nerve cell. So nerve cell are, as I said, these are the structural and functional unit of nervous system, and they are specialized cell for which are used for conducting electrical impulses. So you had a brief introduction about nerve cell in class 9. Now, if you look at the nerve cell very properly, you will see there are basically two parts. One is the cell body, the other is the nerve processes. This is the cell body, and these are the nerve processes. Now, the cell body includes, the dendrite. These are known as, this tiny projection are known as dendrite, and the nucleus. dendrite and nucleus. And in the NR processes, we will say there is, first of all, we will say there are small cell. These are known as Schwann cell. And you will see there are constriction or there are nodes between each cell. These are known as nodes of Ranvier. And at the end, you will see axon terminal. So this is a basic, or this is a typical nerve cell. So the nerve cell will carry conduct impulses. Suppose, let me show you how it does. So suppose this is, there are two nerve cells. So first of all, this nerve cell will receive the electrical impulse and it will transmit it through this nerve cell and it will pass it to the next nerve through the axon terminal, and again it will send it and it will pass it and it will go on and on like this. So the electrical impulses will be received through axon terminal and it will be transmitted to the next nerve through the dendrites. So this is a brief introduction about the nerve cell. Now the central nervous system, as I have said, is mainly made up of two major organs, that is the brain and the spinal cord. Now we'll see the structure of brain. Now the brain is the most important, or the most important organ of our entire body. It is the center of all the information processing. It is the center of all the command in our body. So the brain is it is surrounded and protected by a bony skull. What is skull? The bony part which you see in your head, this is the skull, and the brain is protected by this skull. So under this skull there are three layer of muscular tissue that act as a cushioning in the skull to protect the brain from any external or from any damages. There is three layer of muscular tissue, and the brain and the spinal cord, the brain and spinal cord surrounding. So between, suppose this is the skull, consider this is the skull, and there are three layer of muscular tissue, as I have said, and between this muscle and the brain there is a layer of fluid. There is a layer of fluid that covers the brain and the spinal cord, which act as a shock absorber. This layer of fluid does what? It acts as a shock absorber, and this layer of fluid is known as cerebrospinal fluid. Cerebrospinal fluid. Again, the brain is covered by a bony skull, and it is cushioned by three layer of muscles, and it is also protected by the brain and the spinal cord are protected by a fluid known as cerebrospinal fluid, which act as a shock absorber. Now if you see a lateral section of a brain, means the side view of a brain, you will see that the brain is the brain contain three major part. So the first part is the forebrain. The forebrain is basically the bigger portion of the brain. So this portion of the brain is the forebrain. Let me see. This is the forebrain. This part is the forebrain. And the forebrain, a major part of the forebrain is the cerebrum. The major part is the cerebrum. And this is the midbrain, and this is the hindbrain. So three major part of the brain is the midbrain, forebrain, and hindbrain. Now what are the major parts of the midbrain, forebrain, and hindbrain? We'll discuss it. So let us discuss the forebrain. So the forebrain, the major part of the forebrain is the cerebrum. Cerebrum is the major part of the forebrain. A vast area of forebrain is covered by cerebrum. Its maximum portion, right? Now, what are the function of forebrain? The forebrain, you know, the forebrain, it controls all the voluntary movement. So, voluntary movement, as we have discussed earlier, the movement that are what? That are in our own control, means what, the movement which we direct by ourselves, these are called the voluntary movement. And the forebrain is also the site of memory, emotion, intelligence, as well as, you know, hunger sensation. See the you know, the lesson which you read, the things which what you want to remember are all stored in the forebrain. Every emotion that you display are, you know, processed in the forebrain. And you know, when you get hungry, this hunger sensation is also, you know, produced in the forebrain. And the forebrain is also the reception point of all the sense organ. Now, there are, we know, five sense organ. There are skin, the nose, the eyes, the ear, and the tongue. Means what? All the senses are processed in the forebrain. It is the reception point of the forebrain, of all the sense organ. The forebrain is the reception point of all the sense organs. Now, next up is the midbrain. So, midbrain has one major function. So, midbrain controls all the involuntary action of the body, involuntary movement of the body, with the help of hindbrain. It doesn't do the controlling of the involuntary movement independently. It takes the help of the hindbrain to do the to manage the involuntary activities. Now hindbrain, it control, it has two some major organs. This is the hindbrain has two major organs. This this is cerebellum, and we see the medulla. Yeah, this is the medulla. So, two major part of hindbrain is the cerebellum and medulla, which we will discuss. Now, what are the function of cerebellum and medulla? The major function of cerebellum and medulla is responsible for the blood pressure and vomiting. So, this part, the medulla, it is responsible for blood pressure, the, you know, the rise and drop of blood pressure, and when you feel vomiting or when you do any kind of vomit, the medulla is responsible. And the cerebellum is responsible for balance and precision. Suppose you are, you know, riding a bicycle, right? You are doing some handcraft, you are writing. So, the precision, the accuracy of work is, you know, done by the is maintained by the cerebellum. Now, once again, we will give a brief recap. The forebrain contain of cerebrum, and what are the main function of forebrain? It is the site of memory. It is the site of it is the receptor spot of the sense organ. It is the site of emotion, intelligence, etc. And in midbrain, we see midbrain along with the hindbrain control the involuntary function. Hindbrain, we see there are two major organ of the hindbrain, that is the cerebellum and medulla. The medulla is responsible for blood pressure and vomiting, and cerebellum is responsible for balance and precision. So, we have discussed brain here. This is the whole discussion of brain. So, next part or the next major organ of the central nervous system is the spinal cord. Spinal cord is a stalk-like structure. Suppose this is the brain. There is a stalk-like structure. That starts from the end of the brain. Now we saw that the brain is protected by skull. The spinal cord is also protected by the Bartibel column. The Bartibel column, the cartridges or you know the parts of the Bartibel column that surrounded, they surround the spinal cord and to protect it. Okay. Now, what is the function of spinal cord? You know, the spinal cord act as a bridge or a manager of the brain. It acts as a bridge between the brain and the nerves. The information or the impulses that are received from the nerves are passed to the brain through the spinal cord, and the information or the responses that are generated from the brain are passed through the motor nerves through the spinal cord. Means what? It acts as a bridge between brain and the nerves, and it acts as a manager of the brain and brain. Acts as a manager of the brain. We can say it is a second brain. Now, one of the major or very crucial function of the brain is the reflex action. Reflex action. Now, what is reflex action? So, consider yourself walking on a very rough ground, and suddenly a nail got pierced in your leg. What will you do? You will jump and you know, move your feet away from the nail. So this is reflex action. Reflex action are those action which we do all of a sudden. These are involuntary action which you do all of a sudden. You know, you don't think about it. You just do it all of a sudden when there is a need to do it. Suppose another example, there is a very hot pen. If you put your hand on this hot pen, you will do it instinctively. You will remove your hand because your hand might get damaged. So those action that are done without thinking, without looking, that those action which are instantaneous, these are known as reflex action. So as we have said that brain, you know, the processes all the information and tells the motor nerves to do what to do and what not to do. But the reflex action is solely, you know, managed by the spinal cord. Now see, most of the time in reflex action, we see there are a lot of chances to be damaged, to get the organs damaged, right? So this action need to be done very quickly. So this is done, so the information is not passed into the brain, it is processed then and there in the spinal cord, and the response is made there. So this is known as reflex action. Now to understand reflex action, you need to understand what is a reflex arc. Reflex arc is the diagrammatic representation of reflex action. Now consider a sense organ. Suppose a sense organ, and consider an effector organ. Right? Consider a sense organ. Suppose this is the hand. Suppose this is the hand. And now you have, by mistake, you have put your hand in a hot pan. So this information and this is the spinal cord. So this information will be passed to the spinal cord with the help of a sensory neuron. What is sensory neuron? Sensory neuron are those neurons that carries impulses towards the brain, to the spinal cord, and then the spinal cord will process this message and it will, you know, send a message back to the hand to remove it instantly with the help of motor neuron. Sensory neuron and motor neuron, and sometimes, you know, there is a third neuron that connects the sensory neuron or bridges between sensory neuron and motor neuron. This neuron is known as relay neuron. So we see that there is an arc developing. What is arc? This shape is known as arc. Arc developing. So this arc is called the reflex arc. Reflex arc is nothing but the diagrammatic representation of reflex action. We see the sensory neuron, we see the motor neuron, as well as the relay neuron, and how these neurons coordinate among themselves to perform the reflex action, which is an instantaneous action performed, you know, during a sudden situation. So since the reflex action is performed by the spinal cord, so we don't necessarily need to think about it. We just do it, right? It is the need of the hour. So with this, we have concluded the nervous coordination in human. Next up is the hormonal coordination. Hormonal coordination in humans. Now, before understanding hormonal coordination in human, you need to understand a few terms. What is gland? What is endocrine gland? What is exocrine gland? And what are hormones? Now, what are gland? Glands are those specialized tissues that are, you know, these are specialized to secrete hormones, or glands are those specialized tissue which are specialized for secretion. Glands are those specialized tissue that are specialized for secretion. Now, glands are of two types. One is the endocrine gland and another is the exocrine gland. Okay, don't need to necessarily know. So gland are of two type. So there are first type of gland are those type of gland which, you know, deliver their secretion with the help of a pipe. Suppose this is a gland. Gland A. So when it secretes something, it delivers its secretion with the help of a pipe or duct. So this type of gland are known as ducted gland. Ducted gland, or in biology we say these are exocrine gland. While there are other glands, suppose gland B. Gland B, it does what? It does, it secretes its secretion directly into the bloodstream. Suppose it is secreting something, it will secrete directly into the bloodstream. It does not have a pipe or a duct. So we say they are ductless gland. Ductless glands, or in biology we say them as endocrine gland. So the most of the hormones are secreted by endocrine gland. Since the beginning of the lesson, I am just using a word hormone. Now, this is the key time to know what is a hormone. Hormone. What is a hormone? Hormones are those chemicals, you know, secreted mostly by the endocrine gland to carry messages. These are chemicals secreted by mostly endocrine gland to carry messages for performing a certain function. Now, in this chapter, we will discuss about five major endocrine gland. Endocrine gland. We'll not discuss the exocrine part. We'll just discuss five major endocrine gland in this chapter. Now, the first gland that we are talking about here is the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland. Now, this is the main gland of the body. Now, where is pituitary gland is located, or where it is found? Pituitary gland is found in the bottom region of the forebrain. We have studied brain, right? Three region of the brain: forebrain, midbrain, hindbrain. The forebrain, the major part of the forebrain is the cerebrum, and the cerebrum, and in the bottom region of the cerebrum, suppose this was the cerebrum, in the bottom region of cerebrum we saw there is pituitary gland. We will find the pituitary gland. So pituitary gland is found, okay, I'm writing it, it found in the bottom region of forebrain. It is a part of forebrain. Next up is, it is a very small gland, it is a P-shaped gland. The hormone secreted, now what are the hormones secreted and what are the function of the hormone secreted by pituitary gland? Pituitary gland secrete two major hormones. One is the growth hormone and the other one is the stimulating hormone. Now, what does growth hormone do? Growth hormone are responsible for the growth of, in our body. Remember, in the beginning we have said an advantage of hormones is they are responsible in growth. So the growth growth that take place in your body, the hormone that are responsible behind it is the growth hormone, and the gland that is responsible is pituitary gland. Now, what is stimulating hormone? What do you mean by stimulation? Stimulating hormone are those hormones that stimulate other organ or other glands to do their activity. Okay, for example, there is the pituitary gland. pituitary gland, and there is another gland, gland B. Now, when should the gland B function? How should the gland B function? So this his functioning or his secretion, right? His secretion will be directed by the stimulating hormone released by the pituitary gland. We will understand it more better when we'll discuss the second type of gland. So since the stimulating hormone of pituitary gland regulates the functioning or secretion of other glands, hence it is also known as the master gland. Again, the function of where is pituitary gland located? In the bottom region of forebrain. It's a P-shaped gland. It is a small gland and it releases growth hormone and master gland. Now, what if the functioning of the pituitary gland is disturbed? So, two hormone, growth hormone. When the functioning of pituitary gland will be disturbed, first of all, it will, you know, there will be a disbalance in the release of growth hormone. So, if the growth hormone is released in excessive amount, the person may suffer from gigantism, means what, he will be excessively large. And if the function of growth hormone is, you know, is in less quantity, he will or she will suffer from dwarfism, means what, his body will be underdeveloped. Similarly, if it does not release the stimulating hormone, then the other functioning of other glands will also be disturbed. So the next gland we'll be talking about is the thyroid gland. Second gland is the thyroid gland. Now, where is thyroid gland found? Is found from the name itself, you can understand thyroid gland is found in the thyroid region of the body. Now, the hormone secreted by thyroid gland, a major one is the thyroxine. Now, how this thyroid gland, you know, actually start functioning? The thyroid gland starts secreting thyroxine only after it receives message from pituitary gland. It receives a stimulating hormone from pituitary gland. It receives stimulating hormone from pituitary gland known as thyroid stimulating hormone. See, as I've said earlier, the pituitary gland releases stimulating hormone that directs other glands to function. Here, in case of thyroid gland, we see when the pituitary gland will release thyroid stimulating hormone or TSH, then only the thyroid gland will start to work or function. Now, what are the functions of thyroxine? Now, thyroxine, what does thyroxine actually do in our body? Thyroxine is responsible for metabolism and mental development. Metabolism means what? The rate with which our body function, means what, the functioning of our body, the functioning of the organ is metabolism. Means what, if there is, you know, a disturbance in the release of thyroxine, then our normal bodily function will be disturbed. And if again, if there is a, you know, disturbance in the release of thyroxine hormone, the mental development will be poor or reduced, right? Now there is another there is a mineral that is also, you know, plays a key role in the release of thyroxine hormone. You all know this mineral, that is iodine. You all know what is iodine? Yes, iodine, the one we find in salt. Now, iodine is necessary to release the thyroxine hormone. So when there is a lack of iodine, we say there is a disease known as goiter. We know that goiter. So what happened in goiter? The lungs, thyroid becomes swollen up, the neck, there is a swelling we see in the neck, and the mental development of that particular person is also, you know, affected due to goiter, right? So where is thyroid gland found? In the thyroid region. The hormone release is thyroxine, responsible for metabolism and mental development. If there is and it is released, if there is, you know, a disturbance in the release of thyroxine, it will result in goiter and it will also disturb our mental development. So the third gland which we'll be discussing is the pancreas. Now this is very interesting, pancreas. When you talk about pancreas, it is very interesting. Now, where did you you know, learn what, where did you listen about pancreas in the previously? Sorry? Previously, where did you listen about pancreas? In the life process, in the digestive system. In the digestive system, we saw that pancreas is playing a key role in digestive system. And here in the hormonal coordination, we see again, we see pancreas is playing a key role. So do you remember the two type of gland we are talking about, the endocrine and exocrine? The endocrine means what? The ductless gland, and the exocrine means the ducted gland. So the pancreas is the only gland or only gland of our body that contain, that function as both endocrine gland and exocrine gland. So hence it is also known as mixed gland. So in we have seen the functioning of pancreas as an exocrine gland in the life process. Now we will learn about the endocrine function of pancreas. So you have seen people with diabetes, right? So what exactly happens when a person suffers from diabetes? When a person suffers from diabetes, his blood sugar level is not well maintained. Sometimes he has a very high blood sugar level, or sometimes he has a very low blood sugar level. So the two hormones that are released by the endocrine part of the pancreas is insulin and glucagon. Now what are their function? When your blood sugar level is high, is very high, more than the normal, so insulin will, what insulin will help it to reduce the blood sugar level and bring it back to normal. And when your blood sugar level will be dropped, glucagon will do what? Do the reverse case. It will help the blood sugar level to rise up and bring it to normal. So the next gland is the number fourth gland is the adrenal gland. Where it is found? Adrenal. You have in life process you saw kidney, right? Kidney in excretory system. So in the top part of the kidney, we see two gland. These are called adrenal gland in the top part region of the kidney. So adrenal gland release hormone known as adrenaline. Adrenal gland release a hormone known as adrenaline. Now what is the function of adrenaline again? So adrenaline hormone, you know, help us during emergency time. Remember we have talked about the sympathetic and parasympathetic sympathetic nervous system. In sympathetic we saw it helps during the emergency time. Similarly, adrenaline also helps during the emergency time. It is also known as emergency hormone. Now what exactly is it does? So again, the same example, a dog is chasing you. What you will do? You will run as fast as never before, right? Normally you cannot run that fast. So you will run as fast as ever before. Or sometimes, you know, you are involved in some kind of quarrel and you are involved in a fight. So what will you do if you fight? You will see you will fight in a, you know, very heroically, and you will never know what you are exactly doing. So when you have a fight or flight, means what? When you are running, you have a fight or flight response. This fight or flight response is the result of adrenaline hormone. So it will do what? It will increase your metabolism. It will increase your heart rate. It will increase your, you know, blood flow in the body to compensate your body during an emergency situation. So the last glands we are talking about in this hormonal coordination of human are the gonads. Now what are gonads? Gonads are of two types. In male we say they are testes, and in female we say they are ovaries. Testes and ovaries are togetherly known as gonads. So gonads release some hormone. So the testes releases hormone known as testosterone, and the ovaries releases hormone estrogen and progesterone. So the hormones released by gonads are responsible for the development of secondary sexual character in both the cases. Suppose the secondary sexual character in male, if you say there is, you know, growth of facial hair, you know, developments of Adam's apple, this voice box, and you know, the broadening of shoulders and you know the development of muscle. These are the some secondary sexual character in case of male. In case of female, which you know their voice become shrill, you know there are certain areas where you know there is development, and you see you know they become sexually active, right? So these hormones are responsible. I'm writing the name of hormone. In case of men, this is the testosterone. And in case of women or female, it is estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen and progesterone, testes secretes testosterone, ovary secretes estrogen and progesterone, and they are responsible for the secondary sexual character in the case of both male and female. So with this, we have concluded the coordination in human. With a brief recap and summary, coordination in human two types. The nervous coordination, the hormonal coordination, nervous coordination include the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system include brain and spinal cord. Peripheral nervous system include the sensory nerves and the motor nerve. Motor nerve again divided into somatic and autonomic. Autonomic again divided into sympathetic and parasympathetic. Now, and in hormonal coordination in human, we saw there are five glands: pituitary, thyroid, pancreas, adrenal and the gonads. Finish. Now it's time for the plant. See, plant also show coordination. Plant also show, has its own functioning, its own set of you know metabolism, right? Plant show, we in a lower classes we saw plant grow, plant response to stimuli. So based on this factor, we will discuss the you know coordination in plant. So coordination in plant are of two types. One is the hormonal coordination like human, and one is the response and stimulus coordination. Response and stimulus coordination. We'll discuss it, don't worry. Response and stimulus, I wrote it in a brief, we'll discuss it in the last part. So hormonal coordination. First let us discuss the hormonal coordination in plants. See, plants and plants hormones are otherwise also known, also called as phytohormones. Phytohormones. Phytohormones means the hormones that are found in plant are known as phytohormones. What are the main function of phytohormones? It regulates the growth. So that is why there are two types of phytohormones, are basically of two types. One is the growth promoting hormone and the other is the growth inhibiting hormone. Inhibiting hormone. Growth promoting hormone means what? The hormone that you know promotes growth. That will you know allow the plant to grow, and growth inhibiting hormone is to counterbalance the growth part, means what, it will stop the growth. So there are three hormones that are responsible for growth. The first hormone we are talking about is the auxin. Auxin where is a growth promoting hormone. So the first hormone we are talking about, auxin. Auxin is a growth promoting hormone. It is mainly present in the shoot tip. It is mainly in the shoot tip. We saw that plants are divided into two parts, roots and shoot. The roots is the lower part below the ground, shoot is the part above the ground. In the shoot tip, you will find the auxin hormone, which will you know help in growth. In class 9, you have seen the meristematic hormone. So the meristematic tissue. The meristematic tissues are those tissues which continue division, and auxin is responsible for it. And auxin is a light sensitive hormone. Means what? Auxin is sensitive to light. Suppose one example I am citing here. So an example of dark room. Suppose this is a dark room. There is a window and the plant is in the window. So the plant will tend to grow towards the light. Means what? The towards the light because of the auxin. Because auxin is a light sensitive hormone, it will tend to move away from the light. Suppose this is the sun and this is the plant. So auxin will what? Sun will fall there, sun will be there. So auxin will move away from the sun. Means what? If this is the sun and if it is the plant, auxin will move from this part to their part, and hence the plant will bend and move towards the sun. Auxin is a light sensitive hormone. And obviously it's a growth promoting hormone. The next hormone we are talking about is gibberellin. Gibberellins, some say it's gibberellins. So gibberellins is also a growth promoting hormone. Now, how does it promotes growth? It will help in cell enlargement. It will help in cell enlargement, and it will break the dormancy of seed. Now, what is dormancy? You saw seed from the mango, right? When you eat a mango, you find seed. The plant doesn't grow from the seed then and there. It will take some time to grow up from the seed. So the plant is in a sleep. The seed is in a sleeping position by then, waiting inside the fruit. And after some time, it will break the sleep, and you know the plant will start to grow here. So this breaking of sleep is known as dormancy. This sleeping position is known as dormancy. And breaking of dormancy means what? The seed will become active, and the plant will start to grow. The next growth promoting hormone is cytokinin. From the name, cyto is something related to cell, right? Cyto is something related to cell. Means what? It will help in cell division. Cytokinin hormone will help in cell division, and it will help in the development of fruits and seeds. And thirdly, it is also helping the growth of shoots and buds. Shoot, you know what is shoot, and bud means what? The bud is the tender flower, means what? The new flower, which is still small and tender. This is a bud. So it will help in the growth of shoot and bud. Now we'll talk about one growth inhibiting hormone, that is the abscisic acid. See, abscisic acid, what does abscisic acid does? See, auxin, gibberellin and cytokinin, this will help plant to grow, whereas abscisic acid, which will help the plant, which will, you know, stop the functioning of this growth hormone, and it will not allow the plant to grow. Means what? Now, when the seed is inside the fruit, plant doesn't grow from it. What? It remains in the dormant stage. And abscisic acid is that hormone responsible for the dormancy stage of plant. But we see in case of gibberellin is the hormone that is responsible for breaking the dormancy. But abscisic acid is responsible for keeping the seed in dormancy stage. The next function of abscisic acid is wilting of leaves. When the plant's leaf fall, they shrink. It's called wilting of leaves, and abscisic acid is responsible for it, and it promotes the closing of stomata. You know what is stomata? The pores that are found in plants, leaves especially, these are called stomata. So when the closing of stomata is also guided by the abscisic acid. And the last hormone which we'll be talking is the ethylene. So ethylene is a gaseous hormone, and the main function of ethylene is to ripen the fruit. You know, when the fruits ripen, this is done by the ethylene, and it is the only gaseous hormone found in plant. So the hormonal coordination in plant is over, and the last phase of the chapter is the response and stimuli. Now, in order to understand what is response and stimuli system, we have to understand what is stimuli. Stimuli means what? A change in the external environment. Anything change in the external environment is stimuli. Suppose a heat is a stimuli, because the normal temperature of external environment is changed, it is a stimuli, right? Stimuli means what? A change in the external environment, and when something responds to that change in the external environment, it is known as response, and plants also do respond to stimuli. Now, we all know that plants show movement, right? Plants show movement by growth and by responding to certain stimuli. So plants movement are of two types. So plant will show movement two type. One will be when plant move, it will show growth. And when plants movement are two types. One is dependent on growth, and one is independent on growth. Independent on growth means what? In this category, when plant will move, we'll see growth. But in this category, when plant will move, we'll not see any kind of growth. Rather, we'll see other type of movement. So this type of movement where we see growth is known as tropism. Now, there are so many type of tropism. The first type of tropism, tropism means what? The growth when is dependent on plant. So when plant responds to light, we see, suppose, again the example of dark room, with a plant near the window, right? The plant will tend to grow toward the sun. Means what? The plant will be responding toward the stimuli, external stimuli, that is sun, and the plant will go toward the sun, where the sun is the stimuli, and this type of tropism is known as phototropism. Another type of tropism we see is the growth of plants. The growth of plant that is affected due to gravity, right? We know that the plant grow, defying the gravity. Plants grows defying the gravity, means what? It will grow in reverse of gravity. Means what? Gravity is a stimuli here. Suppose take a plant for example, keep it in a tilted position. Wait a second. Keep it in a tilted position. We will see the plant will grow like this. Means what? It is responding towards the gravitational force of the earth, right? It is responding towards the gravitational force of the earth. This type of response towards the gravitation of earth is known as geotropism. Again, now we'll see the plant also. Suppose you have noticed the tendrils, right, in plant, in some plants view. So there is a plant grow with the help of support, right? They will do what? They will bind their tendrils in the support. Take the bottle gourd plant for example. You see the bottle gourd plants are creepers. They will do what? They will find the support and they will do what? They will grow with the help of the support. Means what? They will respond to touch. When they will touch the support, they will grow with the support. And this is when they will grow, they will respond to a stimuli known as touch. And this type of response is known as thigmotropism. Similarly, plants also respond to water known as hydrotropism. And they also respond to certain chemicals known as chemotropism. Now, what are the some examples of growth of plant? Response of plant independent of growth. A very classic example is the mimosa plant, that is the Tasmanian orchid plant. When you touch the plant, it moves, right? But it doesn't show any growth. So this type of responses to stimuli are independent of growth and are also known as gnostic response. Gnostic response. The growth that are dependent on the movement that are dependent on growth are known as tropic response or tropism, and the movement that are independent of growth are known as gnostic response. For example, Mimosa pudica, and we example the the opening of flower. The opening of flower, when a flower opens, it shows movement but it doesn't show growth. It is also an example of gnostic response. So we have discussed the response, the hormonal and response stimuli coordination in plants. So this is it. So I think all the points of this chapter are being covered, and I hope you find the discussion very useful. And if you have any kind of confusion or any kind of problem, please mention in the comment section below. I'll inshallah respond it. And if you still want a specific point to be discussed, you can call me personally. You know my contact info. And please do subscribe to our channel Al Hira National School and click on the notification bell icon so that you don't miss any video and you can attend the classes on time. With this, I conclude today's class. Have a good day.